Good evening, everybody, and welcome to all. I know most of us know how to join to the Zoom session, but I would just like to focus on certain things. I've seen many of them have not joined to audio, because if Dr. Anil sir would be presenting, and if you have not joined to audio, it will be very difficult for you guys to listen to what he is speaking. So if you're joining from computer setup, once you put your meeting ID, you will come to this phase. So kindly click on the join audio option by clicking on this headphone icon, which you can see on your left bottom side of the screen. Similarly, once you click on it, you will automatically come to this phase where you will see an icon and a cross across this, which shows that you are on mute button. Whenever during the question answer round after sir's presentation, we will allow you to unmute and ask questions, or you can also put your questions by clicking on this chat feature and put your questions. Similarly, people who are joining through phones, after you put your meeting ID, either you have to join by call-in device for your regular phones, and with iPhone users, it is called using internet audio. Please do join to the audio, otherwise you guys won't be able to listen to what Anil sir would be presenting. And to rename yourself, you can click on the participant tab. Take the cursor to your name. You will get a rename option. Please rename yourself with your name, your designation, your district, because it's during the question answer round, we'll be able to identify who is asking that question and from which district. Similarly, in case this is the chat function, in case you have to put chat on the phone, because most of you guys have joined in from phone, click on the more option. You'll find a chat option. You can put your questions in the chat section. We would request everyone to be on the mute unless and until you are asked to unmute yourself and ask your question. Or when a sir is presenting, you can put the questions on the chat, which will be taken at the last post his presentation. And you can either physically raise your hand, ask us to unmute, and we will do that for you during the Q&A round. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Namalde innatha session purely oru ICU management session aanu. Adondu thanne ella jillayil ninnum ICU manage cheyina doctor marku oru TOT ennulla nilaykana oru ee session vechirikkana sir. നമ്മുടെ ഈ ട്രെയിനിങ് ഡിവിഷൻ എൻഎച്ച്എമ്മിന് വേണ്ടിയും ഈ പരിശീലനം അറ്റൻഡ് ചെയ്യുന്ന എല്ലാവർക്കും വേണ്ടി നമ്മുടെ ജോയിന്റ് സെക്രട്ടറി ഹെൽത്ത് ആൻഡ് ഫാമിലി വർക്ക് ഡോക്ടർ ശ്രീരാം വെങ്കട്ടരാമൻ ഐഎഎസിനെ ക്ഷണിച്ചോളും. സർ, ഓവർ ടു യു സർ.
എല്ലാവർക്കും നമസ്കാരം. എനിക്കും നമ്മൾ മൂന്നാമത്തെ പ്രാവശ്യമാണ് ഇപ്പോ മീറ്റ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. അന്ന് ഇത് അറ്റൻഡ് ചെയ്ത ആളുകൾ തന്നെ ആയിരിക്കില്ലേ ഇതും? ഏകദേശം
ചെറിയ വ്യത്യാസം ഉണ്ടായിരിക്കും. ഇത് ഐസിയു മാനേജ് ചെയ്യുന്ന ടീം മാത്രമാണ്, അതുകൊണ്ട് നമ്പർ ഒരു അല്പം കുറവായിരിക്കും. യൂഷ്വലി നമ്മൾ ഉണ്ടാവാറുള്ളത് 300-400 ആൾക്കാരുണ്ടാവാറുണ്ട്. ഇന്നിപ്പോ ഐസിയു മാനേജ് ചെയ്യുന്ന ആൾക്കാർ മാത്രമേ ഉള്ളൂ, അതുകൊണ്ട് തന്നെ ജില്ലയിൽ നിന്ന് ഒരു 20 പേരിൽ താഴെയൊക്കെ ഉണ്ടാവാറുള്ളൂ. ഇന്നിപ്പോ 132 പേരായിട്ടൊക്കെ സെലക്റ്റഡ് ആൾക്കാർ.
ശരി, എന്തായാലും എല്ലാവർക്കും നമസ്കാരം. വളരെ സന്തോഷമുണ്ട് ഇത്രയും നല്ല പാർട്ടിസിപ്പേഷൻ ഇത്തരത്തിലുള്ള പ്രോഗ്രാമുകൾക്ക് കാണുന്നതിൽ. നമുക്കെല്ലാം അറിയാം, കോവിഡിന്റെ മാനേജ്മെന്റിൽ ഏറ്റവും ക്രിട്ടിക്കൽ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഭാഗമാണ് ഇത് തന്നെ. കോവിഡ് ബാധിച്ച ശേഷം ക്രിട്ടിക്കലി ഇല്ലാവുന്ന പേഷ്യൻസിനെ മാനേജ് ചെയ്യുക എന്നുള്ളത്, കാരണം അതാണ് അൾട്ടിമേറ്റ്ലി മോർട്ടാലിറ്റിയുടെ ആ ഒരു നമ്പറിനെ തീരുമാനിക്കുന്നതും. കുറെ കാലം കഴിഞ്ഞ് ഇതിനെപ്പറ്റി നമ്മൾ റിവ്യൂ നടത്തുമ്പോൾ ഒരു സംസ്ഥാനത്തിന്റെ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഒരു സിസ്റ്റത്തിന്റെ സക്സസ് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് പ്രൈമറിലി ഡിസൈഡ് ചെയ്യപ്പെടാൻ പോകുന്നത് ഈ കോവിഡ് ബാധിച്ച് എത്ര പേര് മരിച്ചു എന്നുള്ളത് ആ ഒരു സിംഗുലർ നമ്പർ ആയിരിക്കും ഏറ്റവും ക്രിട്ടിക്കൽ. അപ്പൊ ആ ഒരു നമ്പർ എങ്ങനെ മിനിമൈസ് ചെയ്യാം, എങ്ങനെ ഏറ്റവും കൂടുതൽ ആളുകളെ മരണത്തിൽ നിന്ന് രക്ഷിക്കാം, ഏറ്റവും എങ്ങനെ ഏറ്റവും ഏറ്റവും നന്നായി ഐസിയു മാനേജ് ചെയ്യാം എന്നുള്ളതിനെ സംബന്ധിച്ച് നമ്മൾ അറിഞ്ഞിരിക്കേണ്ടത് വളരെ അത്യാവശ്യമാണ്. അപ്പൊ നിങ്ങളെല്ലാം ഓൾറെഡി ഐസിയു മാനേജ് ചെയ്ത് തരുന്ന ആളുകളാണെന്നാണ് ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കുന്നത്. അപ്പോ നിങ്ങൾക്കെല്ലാം ഒരുവിധപ്പെട്ട കാര്യങ്ങളൊക്കെ അറിയാമായിരിക്കും. എന്നാലും ഒരു സ്റ്റാൻഡേർഡൈസ്ഡ് ആയിട്ട് എങ്ങനെയാണ് ഈ ഒരു കോവിഡ് ബാധിച്ച് ക്രിട്ടിക്കലായി വരുന്ന ആളുകളെ മാനേജ് ചെയ്യുക എന്ന് അറിഞ്ഞിരിക്കേണ്ടത് വളരെ അത്യാവശ്യമാണ്. എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നു നമ്മളൊക്കെ വളരെയധികം ഫോർച്ചുനേറ്റ് ആണ്. കഴിഞ്ഞ രണ്ട് ട്രെയിനിങ് പ്രോഗ്രാംസ് പോലെ തന്നെ ഇതിനെപ്പറ്റി പറഞ്ഞു തരാൻ നമ്മുടെ ഇടയിൽ അവൈലബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഏറ്റവും നല്ല അതോറിറ്റി തന്നെയാണ് ഇത് പഠിപ്പിക്കാനായിട്ട് ഇന്ന് ഇവിടെ വന്നിരിക്കുന്നത്. ഞാൻ ഇന്നലെയും കൂടെ ഡോക്ടർ അനിലുമായിട്ട് ഇന്ററാക്ട് ചെയ്തതേ ഉള്ളൂ. അദ്ദേഹം കുറെ കാര്യങ്ങൾ പറഞ്ഞ അവസാനം എനിക്ക് കോള് കട്ടേണ്ടി വന്നു. താങ്കൾ പറഞ്ഞ് പൂർണ്ണ ഉൾക്കൊള്ളാൻ കുറച്ചധികം കൂടി സമയം വേണമെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് എല്ലാം എഴുതിയെടുത്തിട്ട് ഞാൻ കോള് കട്ടിയാണ് ചെയ്തത്. അപ്പൊ അത്രയ്ക്കധികം അറിവും എക്സ്പീരിയൻസും ഒക്കെ ഉള്ള ആളാണ്. എന്റെ പല ബാച്ച്മേറ്റ്സും അദ്ദേഹത്തിന്റെ സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് ആണ്. അവരിൽ നിന്നൊക്കെ അദ്ദേഹത്തിന്റെ പല പല കഥകളൊക്കെ ഞാൻ കേട്ടിട്ടുണ്ട്. എങ്ങനെയാണ് അദ്ദേഹം ട്രെയിൻ ചെയ്യുന്നത്, വളരെ ഹാൻഡ്സ് ഓൺ ആയിട്ട് വളരെ നല്ല രീതിയിൽ. ഇനി ഒരിക്കലും ഈ ഇദ്ദേഹത്തിന്റെ ട്രെയിനിങ് കഴിഞ്ഞു പോയാൽ വളരെ ഇൻഡിപെൻഡന്റ് ആയിട്ട് ഒരു ICU പൂർണ്ണമായി മാനേജ് ചെയ്യാനുള്ള ഒരു കഴിവ് അദ്ദേഹത്തിന്റെ സ്റ്റുഡൻസിന് ഉണ്ടാവും എന്നാണ് ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കിയത്. എന്തായാലും ഡോക്ടർ അനിൽ സത്യദാസിനെ തന്നെ നമുക്ക് ഈ ട്രെയിനിങ് ലീഡ് ചെയ്യാൻ കിട്ടി എന്നുള്ളത് വലിയ ഭാഗ്യമാണ്. അപ്പോ ഇതിനേക്കാൾ വിപുലമായ രീതിയിൽ വളരെ ഹാൻഡ്സ് ഓൺ ആയിട്ട് തന്നെ ഇന്റൻസീവ് ആയിട്ട് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ICU ട്രെയിനിങ് നമ്മൾ ഒരുപാട് പ്ലാൻ ചെയ്തിരുന്നു. നമുക്കെല്ലാം അറിയാം, ഒരു ഒരു ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റ് പ്രോട്ടോകോൾ പഠിക്കുന്ന പോലെയോ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഒരു തിയറട്ടിക്കൽ ലെവലില് മാത്രമായി ഒതുങ്ങേണ്ട ഒരു ട്രെയിനിങ് അല്ല ക്രിട്ടിക്കൽ കെയർ ട്രെയിനിങ് എന്നുള്ളത്. തീർച്ചയായിട്ടും ഒരു ഒരു ബെഡ് സൈഡ് ക്ലാസ്സും ഹാൻഡ്സ് ഓൺ എക്സ്പീരിയൻസും ഇൻഡിപെൻഡന്റ് ആയിട്ട് പേഷ്യൻസിനെ ഡീൽ ചെയ്തും ഒക്കെ ഒരു ശീലം അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഒരു പ്രാക്ടീസ് വന്നാൽ മാത്രമേ ഒരു ക്രിട്ടിക്കൽ സിറ്റുവേഷനിൽ, ഒരു എമർജൻസി സിറ്റുവേഷനിൽ വളരെ ക്ലിയർ ആയിട്ട് ഡിസിഷൻ എടുക്കാനും പേഷ്യന്റിന് ഏറ്റവും ഗുണം വരുന്ന രീതിയിൽ ആ പേഷ്യന്റിനെ മാനേജ് ചെയ്യാനും നമുക്ക് സാധിക്കുകയുള്ളൂ. എന്നാലും ഇതൊരു പ്രൈമറായിട്ട് നമുക്ക് കാണാം, ഇതിന്റെ ഒരു തുടക്കമായിട്ട് കാണാം. ഇതിൽ നിന്നൊക്കെ മോട്ടിവേറ്റ് ആയിട്ട് നിങ്ങളുടെ സൈഡിൽ നിന്ന് നിങ്ങൾ ഈ മെസ്സേജ് നിങ്ങളുടെ കൊളീഗ്സിന് പാസ് ഓൺ ചെയ്യുക. നിങ്ങളുടെ സൈഡിൽ നിന്ന് തന്നെ ഇനി ഡിമാൻഡ് ഡ്രിവൺ ആയിട്ട് വേണം നമുക്ക് ട്രെയിനിങ് പ്രോഗ്രാം ചെയ്യാൻ എന്ന് ഞങ്ങൾ ഈ അടുത്ത കാലത്ത് പഠിച്ചു. അപ്പൊ ആ ഒരു ഡിമാൻഡ് നിങ്ങളുടെ സൈഡിൽ നിന്നും വരും എന്നും കൂടി ഞാൻ പ്രതീക്ഷിക്കുന്നു. എന്തായാലും അധികം ദീർഘിപ്പിക്കുന്നില്ല, നമ്മുടെ ട്രെയിനിങ് പ്രോഗ്രാമുകളുടെ അറയിൽ ഏറ്റവും ക്രിട്ടിക്കൽ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു ട്രെയിനിങ് ആണ് ക്രിട്ടിക്കൽ കെയർ ട്രെയിനിങ്. അതുകൊണ്ട് എല്ലാവരും വളരെ ശ്രദ്ധയോടെ കേൾക്കുക. പിന്നെ എന്നത്തെയും പോലെ ഞാൻ പറയാതെ തന്നെ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് അറിയാം, നിങ്ങളുടെ ഇന്ററാക്ഷൻ ആണ് അതിനേക്കാൾ എല്ലാം ഏറ്റവും വിലപ്പെട്ടത്. എല്ലാവരും വളരെ നല്ല രീതിയിൽ ഇന്ററാക്ട് ചെയ്യുക, നിങ്ങളുടെ ഡൗട്ട്സ് അയച്ചു കൊടുക്കുക. അപ്പോൾ കുറേയൊക്കെ ഇവിടെ തന്നെ അഡ്രസ്സ് ചെയ്യും, പക്ഷെ എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നു അത് കൂടാതെ ഇവിടെ അഡ്രസ്സ് ചെയ്യാൻ സമയമില്ലാത്ത ഡൗട്ട്സ് എല്ലാം നമ്മൾ കൊളേറ്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് ഡോക്ടർ അനിൽ സത്യദാസിന് അയച്ചു കൊടുക്കുകയും അദ്ദേഹത്തിന്റെ റെസ്പോൺസ് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എല്ലാം ഇമെയിൽ ചെയ്ത് തരികയും ചെയ്യും. അപ്പോ ഒരിക്കൽ കൂടി ട്രെയിനിങ് ടീം, ഡോക്ടർ ദിവ്യ, എക്കോ ടീം ആൻഡ് മോസ്റ്റ് ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻ്റ് ഡോക്ടർ അനിൽ സത്യദാസ് പിന്നെ ഇവിടെ ട്രെയിനിങ്ങിന് വന്ന എല്ലാവർക്കും നന്ദി പറയുന്നു. വളരെ യൂസ്ഫുൾ ആയിട്ട് എല്ലാവരും എടുക്കട്ടെ എന്ന് ആശംസിക്കുന്നു. താങ്ക് യു.
Words and I thank organizers for giving me this opportunity. So topic, as you know, it's critical care in COVID. So I will not be covering the medical part, the drugs and all those things related to COVID. I will not be covering. I hope it has already been covered. So the most important change that would occur for a doctor that would go to treat COVID patients is this. So we are supposed to put in all the PPE as per the situation demands. Okay, so if you are going to intubate, you should be having all the coverall, the face mask, N95 face shield, all those things should be there. So depending on the scenario that we are going to face, you should have personal protective equipments, and this makes things bit problematic. So when you go in like this, all the staff in the ICU would look similar and the patient will not recognize us. So first thing you have to do in the ICU is to introduce yourself to the patient. So I am doctor such and such, or whatever, who I am in charge of this ICU, and I am the person who is looking after you. You have to introduce yourself first, and you may also write on the PP before you go in that that your name can be written there, or you can even identify yourself as the doctor. So that is very simple things that you should follow. If not, the patient will not be able to recognize you. You might even complain that doctor has not come to see the patient. So, and this I hope you have seen in many of the presentations, but it is quite important to know the timeline. So when you present a case to your colleagues or your MOs or seniors, you should tell what is the day of starting of symptoms. So it could be day, say 7 of symptoms onset, day 2 on in ICU, and day 1 on non-invasive ventilation. So that is how you should present, because you expect some complications during a particular period. Maybe your cytokine release syndrome would be more common, say around 8 to 10 days time or 6 to 8 days time. So keeping that in mind, also most of the medical management, the drugs and the convalescent plasma would be preferred in the initial stages rather than the late stages. So that also would be if you can tell the timeline, it would be very easy to determine or decide what all treatment this particular patient would need. And another thing is that your viral infectivity would be very less, say, after the 10th day. So it's always nice to present as the timeline. Also, the comorbidities should also be mentioned. Okay, and the severity of the disease, definitely. So keeping this graph in mind, we'll go to the next. When do you say the patient to be having a critical COVID or maybe a severe COVID, but more apt definition is a patient is named as critical when the patient is having respiratory failure. Yes, we are going to discuss that in detail. Requiring mechanical ventilation. So he might be coming to your ICU before he becomes critical, and he may go into the critical stage when he requires mechanical ventilation, or the patient goes into shock, which is seen but not very commonly. And it could be another scenario would be a patient coming to your ICU for other organ failure. Suppose very commonly we would see acute kidney injury. So they should come to your ICU for renal replacement therapy or SD hemodialysis. So such patients are also called as critical. And can we predict beforehand whether this patient would go for the critical stage or the severe stage? There are many scores, but one such example is a COVID gram critical illness risk score, which has many components, especially the age, okay, X-ray abnormalities, dyspnea, and the neutrophil leukocyte ratio, NLR, and number of comorbidities. So this will give you like either as a percentage, or it will, you can even group these patients having low risk for turning into critical, median risk, or a high risk group, depending upon the percentage that is shown in the table. So we can predict, there are many other scores also. So you can predict, and then what you should do is that you have to monitor these patients very closely, either in the ward or in a step down ICU or in your main ICU. So if the patient has a high chance of going bad, as shown in this risk score, you should closely monitor this patient. So that is what we should be doing. And I'll be talking about this work of breathing throughout the presentation. So why do you want to do work to breathe? So that is the first question. And how difficult it would be when you have a fluid-filled alveoli. So normally, the work that should be done is to inflate the alveoli. So something like a balloon. Okay. So you want to inflate a balloon, you should do work to overcome the natural property of the balloon to come to the smallest volume. So that is called the elastic property, and that can be expressed as the elastance. So you have to overcome the tendency of the balloon to come back to the smallest volume, that is elastance. And also, you are blowing through a narrow tube. Okay, you have the endotracheal tube, you have the trachea, you have the bronchus. So any tube through which the gas or liquid flows would offer resistance. So you have to overcome the resistance also. So this is both together would account for your work of breathing. And that would be very much raised when you have a very stiff lung or a fluid-filled lung, as in ARDS COVID. In normal patients, it is just 5% of the total oxygen consumed or total energy expended, only 5% is for work of breathing. But beware, when the lungs go bad, when you have severe bronchospasm, the work that is done for breathing increases drastically. And sometimes a failing heart or a heart that is not very good might find it difficult to supply the oxygen. The work means oxygen. So you should give oxygen to the muscles. Then only it will be able to go for aerobic metabolism. And how can you identify the work of breathing in a pressure volume loop? You have just like a work is equal to force into distance. You can say work is equal to pressure into volume. So this is being shown as the ventilator driving gases through the narrow tube into the balloon to inflate that. As you know, we have a patient in respiratory failure, and these patients could have either type 1 or type 2 respiratory failure. So as you know, in type 1, we don't have retention of carbon dioxide, whereas in type 2, we have retention of carbon dioxide. Both would have hypoxemia. So how can you quantify hypoxemia? So when you say the patient is ABG is having a PO2 of, say, 100, does it tell us anything? No. It is always compared with the FiO2. FiO2 is a fraction of oxygen the patient is getting. or percentage of oxygen. So if it is 40%, the FI2 would be 0.4. Okay. So always say the PO2 in comparison to the FiO2. Okay. So that's otherwise called the P by F or PF. Okay. If you don't have ABG, you can also compare the SpO2 to FiO2. So one person did a study, and that is called as a Kigali's index. That is in African population, and found that anything less than 315 corresponds to your ARDS. So that also can be used, but most of us would prefer to have the P by F rather than the S by F. So P small a is the arterial partial pressure of oxygen in the artery, so you need to have a ABG. And we'll see what are the causes of hypoxemia. Okay, so we know that you have a normal people would have a normal ventilation perfusion. There is no mismatch, it is perfectly matched. Okay, so you could have hypoxemia when you have a low V by Q. Okay, so low V by Q can occur when you have a low ventilation or high perfusion. So we'll see in the picture, the pictorial representation, we assume this to be perfectly normal. So imagine you need 100 molecules of oxygen to oxygenate the blood, that is shown in red tube. Okay, and there is 100 molecules of oxygen in the alveoli. Everything is perfect, there is no mismatch. Okay, sometimes the scenario would be different. Instead of the 100, you would have only 80 molecules of oxygen in the alveoli. So the blood needs 100. So will it be fully oxygenated? No. So what is the cause of the decrease in the oxygen molecules in the alveoli? It could be pus filling, it could be fluid filling. Okay. Third thing, so there is low ventilation compared to perfusion. So there is low V by Q. Okay. Third scenario is one where you have total block of the particular alveoli. Not even one molecule of oxygen is going into that alveoli. Okay. So that could occur when you have atelectatic alveoli, when the alveoli are 100% filled with pus or fluid. Okay, not even one molecule of oxygen go into that alveoli. So what would be the scenario? Not even one molecule of oxygen go into the blood, and that scenario is typically called as a true shunt. Okay, true shunt, and that will occur in ARDS. Okay, so what is the next scenario we are going to look at? We are going to see a scenario where you have more perfusion compared to your ventilation. That means there is 100 oxygen molecules in the alveoli ready to oxygenate the blood, but the blood needs, for example, 120. So why is that occurring? Because of dysregulated perfusion. So this occurs in COVID, and that is the cause of that happy hypoxemia, which we'll discuss later. So the last scenario is a scenario where the alveoli are innocent, there is oxygen, but there is excess perfusion. So normally you have hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction, which should constrict the blood vessels passing through non-aerated alveoli. That is a normal process. That is a protective mechanism. Okay. So this is the cause of hypoxemia, either low ventilation or high perfusion. Next cause of hypoxemia is diffusion imbalance. It's very simple to understand. The alveolar capillary membrane ideally should be one cell thick. Okay. So it's so thin so that the oxygen find it easy to diffuse into the blood. But when there is ARDS, you have total damage, and that will produce a very thick alveolar capillary membrane, and that will prevent oxygen to go across that membrane very smoothly or very easily. So that is diffusion impairment. And last but not the least, you have a hypoventilating alveoli. So that means there is total block. So as you know, it is a procoagulant state. You have a total block of the vessels that is supplying that particular alveoli. So when there is a block, what would happen? The whole gases that come up to the alveolar level would not take part in gas exchange, and that will account to your dead space, and that will decrease the alveolar ventilation. So hypoventilation can occur when you have a block in your blood vessels. So the whole system till the alveoli, including the alveoli, would be called as dead space ventilation because it's not taking part in gas exchange. So this is regarding hypoxemia. We'll go to what is literally happening in COVID. So as you know, you have ACE2 receptors in many parts of the body. So we are more concerned with your lungs, where it goes, and this ACE2 receptors are seen in your type 2 pneumocytes. Okay. So with the spike protein, they enter the pneumocytes, and produce initially they produce vasodilatation. I already said vasodilatation can produce hypoxemia. It abolishes hypoxemic pulmonary vasoconstriction. That is really bad. So hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction was good, and it has initially it has some anti-inflammatory, anti-fibrotic action, but later the pathophysiology changes into vasoconstriction, cell proliferation, and a fibrotic stage. So almost the later stage is very typical of a typical classical ARDS, whereas the initial stages differ from the classical ARDS criteria or picture. Okay, so this is what is happening in COVID pathophysiology. And as we said, we can divide the hypoxemia as that caused by dysregulation of the pulmonary perfusion with microthrombosis. So that is hypoventilation on the left side, which would produce a lung that is not very heavy, that is not very much fluid filled. Okay, so you call it as a low V by Q, but then you call it as low elastance, low recruitability. You have nothing to recruit because the lung has, the alveoli are already opened, and limited PEEP responses. So that's called the light category or the low category, and that is labeled as the L type. As the other end, end of the spectrum, we have the typical classical ARDS picture, which is non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, and we have the fluid-filled alveoli, total damage is there. You have a very high right to left shunt, which will produce hypoxemia. But then you might try to recruit these alveoli, which are collapsed or fluid-filled, and they might have a higher PEEP response. And that is called the H-type. And remember, if your treatment is not adequate, or if you are not stepping up your support that you're going to give for patients who are on, just say, HFNC or NIV, you're not intervening at the right time, you're not intubating, then the L-type can progress to the H-phenotype. Okay. So that is very important to identify these patients who need extra support, or those patients who should go to the next level of treatment. Okay. And also remember, because of the neurotropism, this patient should have a high respiratory drive. And this picture has been seen in many of the presentations right from our MBBS days. So as you know, it would attack your type 2 cells here, type 2 pneumocytes, which has ACE2 receptors, and it would produce diffuse alveolar damage. That is the pathognomonic pathology that occurs in typical classical ARDS, bad diffuse alveolar damage. So your alveoli are totally filled with proteinous fluids, and a lot of inflammatory mediators would be there, and there would be epithelial damage, and there would be leakage from the vasculature into your interstitial space, and from there into your alveoli. And pulmonary edema occur, which is typically non-cardiogenic. Okay, and there are a lot of inflammatory exudates, and especially the IL-6, IL-1, TNF-alpha, and things like that. And so your alveoli will get consolidated. And the degree of deep consolidation correlates with the shunt. So that correlates with the hypoxemia, and also later stages, patient would have, as a complication, patient would have pulmonary hypertension, including acute RV failure and acute core pulmonary. So we talked about this happy hypoxemia, and that is otherwise called a silent hypoxemia, and we said it is because of a vascular problem rather than the alveoli getting fluid filled. So how would the patient look like? They would be literally happy. Okay, they will not, even if you ask how are you, I'm okay. But you would get frightened when you look at the pulse oximeter, it might be reading 70 or 68. They are happy. So the SpO2 would be low, patient will not complain of dyspnea, the respiratory rate might be high or even normal. So these patients might usually they have a low carbon dioxide. So what options do we have for them? You give oxygen, so the blood vessel needs 120, your alveoli, you give 120. So it would be correcting the hypoxemia. So venturi mask, which is a fixed performance device, you could also use a non-rebreathing mask or even go to the extent of NIV. And you have to monitor the work of breathing for this patient. That is so very important. So we'll see how to work, monitor the work of breathing. So especially look for the rate. Rate is good, but not perfect. You can look for paradox. You can see how deeply the patient takes in a breath. So they would have breaths that would have tidal volume almost a liter. Okay, if the patient is on NIV, you could see them developing tidal volume as high as a liter with very little pressure support. Okay, and look for distress. You ask them if there is distress. And another option is to have a flush rate. Flush rate is very high rate, say 30 liters of oxygen through the NRB. Plus, you can add on nasal prongs. These are some of the tricks that would like prevent us intubating the patient. Okay. You try all these things for relatively stable patient only, not for patient who has a very rate of say 45 and is taking deep breaths and your heart rate goes to 140, and not for such patient, but relatively stable patients you can try high FiO2s. But remember, you should try to step up your treatment or intubate patients who have high carbon dioxide. Retaining carbon dioxide is very bad and struggling to meet demand. Okay, large inspiratory effort, all these accessory muscles are working, they would literally fail. They would go into an arrest. And patients who have altered drowsy, altered level of consciousness, patients should also be, you should give step up the treatment or directly go for intubation. So that is happy hypoxemia. And there is something else that can also tell you that patient might go bad or patient would go bad is something called as stress hypoxemia or hypoxemia. Very typically, very commonly seen, patient parayum bathroom poyittu varanu bhayangara stress mood. Okay, so that is, you can monitor that. You can say that you can do the baseline SpO2. You try the ask the patient to just move around. Don't overexert him. And mild activity for 30 seconds or 60 seconds, reassess SpO2. And if the SpO2 falls by more than 3 to 5%, it's a red flag sign. So the patient can go bad even at a later stage. And we have seen, this is one of our exercises that we have in our, for one of the patients we had in our ICU. And you can see extensive lesions, bilateral. Most of the time it's bilateral, and they would appear as bad as a second X-ray also. But then see, most of them are peripherally distributed. The consolidation are peripherally distributed, so well exemplified in the first X-ray. Okay, you can see the peripheral distribution of the consolidation here, and also being the consolidation being developed in the periphery. So that is as some level specificity, or like whatever we can say, this is COVID even without having a positive COVID results. And because it is very difficult to get the X-ray person, the cassette all in your ICU, if you have a spare ultrasound, please take it in your ICU and do a lung ultrasound, which is quite very easy to study also and very easy to find the specific or typical features in the COVID patient. So you have pleural thickening. So as I said, it is subpleural consolidation. So pleura will also be involved. So there's pleural thickening. There will be B lines. B lines indicates a wet lung. Okay, you will have fluid filled. And there could be pneumonia. There could be consolidation, which is seen with your air bronchogram, which like a light minni kattunna pole thonum. So you can see these white spots. They would just brighten up when during inspiration. So that's called the air bronchogram. So, and these are the B lines that I've mentioned. You have a thick pleural line. And what they say is that if you find the B lines both anteriorly as well as posteriorly, this patient is uniformly fluid filled and might not respond with proning, but they might respond with a high PEEP. Whereas if you find B lines and consolidation only in the posterior region, the article suggests that they might benefit from a prone position. Okay. So we'll see if you could identify the characteristic features. We already talked about the subpleural thing. We talked about B lines. Consolidation could be either involving non-translobar, or it could involve multi-lobes, and air bronchograms would be there. A lines, appearance of A lines. A lines are usually normal and they occur during the recovery phase. So you can daily do this and see if the patient is recovering or patient is going bad. Pleural effusions are uncommon, so it's a negative sign. So we will just see if you can, it's quite simple to do these things. You can use a curvilinear probe. Okay. So we'll go to what we have to offer these patients. So starting from simple oxygen therapy, your support would extend even to ECMO. So which all patients would you select? Would you go for your simple nasal cannula? So as you know, this can be even tried in ward. So generally speaking, patients who have almost a good P by F, 200 to 300. And also remember, the FiO2 you would get, you would give to the patient when you keep the corresponding flows in the oxygen flow meter. So when you keep 1 liter, it would be 24%, or it is FiO2 is 0.24. So every 1 liter you add, that increases by 4. So you should note the FiO2. Then only you can calculate the P by F. Okay. So if the patient is not improving, is not the P by oxygenation is not adequate, we can go for a simple face mask. And then the indication is P by F of 200. Again, very similar indications. And you should also note down the FiO2 with the corresponding. So the minimum oxygen that you keep with a simple face mask is 5 liters. If you keep less, there will be rebreathing. And there is no need to go above 8. So it is maybe waste of oxygen when you keep more than 8. So by 8, you can go up to even 60% oxygen. So another option you can jump from your simple face mask is the non-rebreathing mask. So it has a reservoir bag where the oxygen would get collected during the expiratory pause, and the patient can take gases from the bag as well as whatever is coming to the patient. But remember, the flow rates are a bit higher. So you can even go up to 10 to 15 liters in a non-rebreathing mask. And remember, they have multiple valves in them which will prevent the rebreathing. So gases would go out and the patient exhales. And whatever he takes in would not come from the atmosphere. It would be taken from the bag as well as from the tube that is connected to the flow meter. And if still the patient is not maintaining oxygenation and see the work of breathing is high, one of the devices that has very good evidence, especially during the recent COVID pandemic, is the HFNC or high flow nasal cannula. So there is a lot of evidence. Even before we had evidence for use in respiratory failure, but the evidence has increased, and this is okay. The advantages of this is that you have a high flow. Okay, you have heated humidified oxygen or gases going to the patient. So it's a very simple device. It costs you around 3 lakh rupees, and you have an interface that is called nasal cannula. We'll discuss that in this slide. Okay, so which all patients would you go for high flow nasal cannula? What they said, it's like P by F can be as low as 150. Okay, so 150 to 300, you can still stick on with your HFNC. Okay, and saturation is less than 94. That is when we call it as a moderate case. And patients have a relatively high work of breathing. So look at the respiratory rate, look at the effort that the patient puts in, look into accessory muscle use. Okay, and ideally, they should be nursed in a negative pressure room, which is again very scarce. Or if you don't have negative pressure, you can select a single room with good ventilation. And it has been shown that it decreases the intubation rate in patients who have respiratory failure, especially in the group which have a P by F less than 200. Okay, so what all things should be set? So you have, these are the parts, we'll see the parts. So this is the nasal interface that should be changed between patients. That is, we'll see the enlarged diagram in the next slide. This is the main unit which has a humidifier, which is basically heated. That's called a heated humidifier. And this is the chamber into which the sterile water comes in automatically. And this is the tube that goes to the patient. And this is the flow meter. Actually, you should have special flow meters that would can give flows as high as 30 liter per minute. Our normal flow meters will not give that much. It will give around 15 liters per minute. But we have special flow meters that might come with the machine. You can use that up to 30 liters. You can give flows. So what are the things that you should set on HFNC would include the flow rate. So this flow rate is set on the machine. Okay. Then you can set the temperature. So you have three settings. I think it's 31, 34, and 37. So depending upon the comfort of the patient, you can start with 34, and you see patient, if it's hypothermic and things, you can go for 37. 37 is normal body temperature. So you tolerate that. And you can, that is again set on the machine. And here you can see that the FiO2 is not set on the machine. Remember, the FiO2, the fraction of oxygen patient should be getting, is not set on the machine, but it is adjusted by adjusting the flow rate in the oxygen flow meter. So that occurs in the oxygen flow meter. By increasing the flow rate, you can see the FiO2 increasing. The machine will measure the FiO2, will show you the FiO2, what percentage patient is getting, but you adjust the FiO2 by adjusting the flow in the flow meter, oxygen flow meter assembly. Okay. And this is the interface. You can see it does not interfere with speech, does not interfere with eating. Very comfortable position, very lightweight, and you can see the patient smiling. And this is the flow meter. So by adjusting the flow meter, you can adjust the FiO2. So when you increase the flow meter, the oxygen flow, you can automatically see a rise in the FiO2 that is shown on the equipment or the machine. So this is the interface, and there are different techniques or methods by which your HFNC, the high flow rate, would help you out. So it has a positive end expiratory pressure. It helps in alveolar recovery. That is because of that high flow rate. Flow rates, you will see how it is being set. And it even washes out carbon dioxide. So it decreases dead space and even helps to remove carbon dioxide. Quite good machine. And it improves oxygenation as well. It also decreases the work of breathing. And so let's see the problem that it would create. We naturally know when the flows are high, there will be a lot of aerosol generation. Okay. So they did a study and found that the aerosol generation was equivalent to a simple face mask at 15 liters per minute. So what we have to do is that we have to monitor the work of breathing. So I've told you should monitor closely the work of breathing in such patients, because you might feel that everything is okay and the patient would crash. So patient comfort, okay, respiratory rate, SpO2, flow rate, FiO2, these are things that you said. And please switch over to NIV or intubation if there is no clinical improvement in 1 to 2 hours time. Patient is worsening. Okay. The patient ideally should improve with your HFNC in 1 to 2 hours. That is the maximum time you can spend. If the patient improves, patient feels comfortable, the saturation improves, everything is good, you can continue with HFNC. But please step up the treatment modality if the patient is not improving. Or you see that patient needs increasing the flow rate. You start with 30, patient goes to 40, 50, and even 60 liters per minute. Patient is not improving. You need to increase the flow rates further. And you will need to increase the FiO2 also. You start with, you can't come down on your FiO2. You actually start with a higher FiO2 and come down gradually as the patient improves. Okay, or the patient retains carbon dioxide. So these are the indications to step up your treatment modality. Okay. So we'll see how to start the machine. So start with 30 to 40 liters per minute, okay, that you can set on the machine. And FiO2, you start with high. So you give maximum flow, say 15 or 20 liters oxygen flow meter, you see what FiO2 patient is getting, and that should be ideally around 80 to 90%. And then you can come down depending on the SpO2, PaO2, patient comfort, work of breathing, all these things you can see, and then come down on the FiO2. And temperature, as I've already said, depending on the patient comfort. So there is one scoring system that will tell you if your patient would need intubation, or rather than would the patient would fail the HFNC. Okay, that's called the ROCS index, that is respiratory rate oxygenation index, and that is nothing but your S by F, that is SpO2 by FiO2, that divided by the respiratory rate. Okay, so you can see both patients having the S by F is almost same, but one patient is having a higher respiratory rate and the ROCS index is very less, only 3.29, whereas in this patient who has a rate of 25, the ROCS index is high. So remember, respiratory rate is one thing that the patient, you should look into patients, okay, for identifying a failed therapy. And you have something called at around 12 hours, when your ROCS index is less than 3.89, it has more negative predictive value. So it will tell you that almost 80 to 90% of the patient would fail the trial. So it has more negative value. So more than 12 hours, if it is less than 4.8, then almost 90% patients would fail the trial. So another option that we have, it is not superior, maybe not superior, but then you would always think to switch to NIV if patient is not tolerating the HFNC. Okay. But studies have showed that HFNC is quite good in COVID, ARDS or respiratory failure. So we can give NIV, non-invasive ventilation, with either the PACA, the typical ICU ventilator with the dual limb circuit, or you can give the NIV with the BiPAP machine. So ideally, you should give NIV with the ICU ventilator with the dual limb circuit. Okay. In case you don't have, we have scarcity of ICU ventilators. We don't have ICU, ICU ventilator for in the NIV mode. We would select the BiPAP machine. So this BiPAP machine has only one limb. Okay, only the gases come to the patient. The gases, the patient exhale goes to the atmosphere. So that is via a vented mask. So when you are using a single limb circuit for non-COVID, non-COVID patients, you have masks which have lot of holes in them. These are called vented mask, or you might use a vented connector. But this is not to be used in COVID patient. As you know, it will produce the virus which come out. So don't use a vented mask when you're using a BiPAP machine. Always use a non-vented mask as shown in the figure. Okay. This is a non-vented mask. This is a non-vented connector. And this is a bacterial and viral filter. That's called a DuoGuard. Okay. One of the best filters that we have here. After the connector, so you keep that, we'll see in the next diagram. So you keep that the bacterial viral filter just below the connector, and so the patient should need a port for exhalation. That should always be there. We are avoiding the ports in the mask and the connector. So you keep a leak port. This is called as a leak port, and this is the leak, the hole through which the patient's exhale gases would go out. And actually, this is not the leak port. This is the port to which you can connect the oxygen. So, BiPAP machines, you can either connect the oxygen to the back of the machine, or you can connect it in the circuit also. So, you can connect in the leak port. So, all this have been mentioned. So, which all patients would you select for NIV? Any patient who has a PVI of 150 to 300. Increase work of breathing. But again, like we said for HFNC, you should closely monitor the work of breathing and look for something that would transfer or change the L phenotype to H phenotype, and that is called the PCLI, that is patient self-induced lung injury. We have heard about VILI, ventilation-induced lung injury, but this term has come out with respect to COVID, where the patient takes in deep breaths and has a very high transpulmonary pressure, and the patient goes into a damaged mode that you have to detect very early, and that is why I said you have to step up your treatment depending upon the work of breathing. Okay. I think this would be more self-explanatory. So this is the first left side picture is the mask with holes that should not be used. So you use a non-vented mask and a non-vented connector, and below the connector we place the bacteria and viral filter, and below that we place the leak port. So you can identify the leak hole here. Okay, and then the tubing would come. So the patient exhale gases would come out, but it would come out only after being filtered by the viral filter. So that is the advantage. You have to modify the circuit. And comparing the different interfaces that we have in non-invasive ventilation, studies have shown that a helmet type of interface is the best for non-invasive ventilation. Okay, so it's not available commonly because all the Western countries have procured this. And it's not easily available. So helmet type of interface that you can see in that picture has more evidence compared to the oronasal mask seen in the right side picture. And always keep in mind this awake prone position. That's called as CARP or COVID awake repositioning proning protocol. Any patient, right from patients needing oxygenation or even being monitored without oxygenation, you can tell them to change the position. Okay. And even lie prone when they sleep or when they're awake, you can ask them to rotate every 2 hours. So any patient who has respiratory embarrassment enough to be admitted in hospital, need not be always on oxygen therapy, you can ask them to get prone by themselves. That's called awake prone. Very simple thing. We need a cooperation from the patient, and many patients accept that. Okay, even with HFNC, they get prone. NIV would be a bit difficult, but if they can keep their head by the side and they are very cooperative, you can keep a pillow under the chest and then ask them to get prone, and that will help avoid intubation in many patients. So you can see in this picture, in a supine patient, I think we'll be discussing that later also. You can see many of the alveoli are collapsed or they are compressed rather than collapsed, compressed. Okay. And because most of the lung volume is in the posterior part. Okay. So because of the lung weight and the fluid filling and the gravity, you can see many of them are compressed or collapsed. Whereas when you lie prone, we can see there is more even distribution of the volume in the alveoli. So what they say is that it is better matching of the ventilation perfusion when you lie prone. That is the mechanism. So we talked about simple nasal cannula, we talked about simple face mask, non-rebreathing mask, HFNC, NIV. So how do you assess the work of breathing? So we all said that we will come back to work of breathing. Just ask the patient, how are you? Patient will say, typically say, I'm okay. So you can say, compared to yesterday, how are you today? I'm better, maybe same. Okay. So when they are no more happy, it tells you that the work of breathing has increased. Okay. They put in large effort for each breath. Aanyi valikkunnu nenjingana rate koodanonilla pashcha that deep breaths aayirikku edukkunnu. You can see intercostal introit, you can see sternocleidomastoid muscles acting. Paradoxical breathing, normally you want your chest rise along with your abdominal rise, that is normally during inspiration. Paradoxical is the other way around. So when your chest rise, your abdomen go down, and when the chest exhales goes down, your abdomen will come out. So that is paradoxical breathing. Okay. And what they say is large swings in CPA. The exact cutoff is not being described for how large would be the swing to say that work of breathing is high. So you can see when you are connected, if you have a central line and you are connected to the CVP manometer, you can see large fluctuations in the or movement of the water column or the saline column that would represent increased work of breathing. And if the patient is already on NIV, you can see that they develop larger tidal volume, say 9 to 9.5 ml per k predicted body weight. Okay. And if you're lucky, maybe you're not all the time, esophageal pressure monitor, if you have a device to measure that, that reflects your pleural pressure. And the more effort the patient takes, it would be more negative. So anything more than minus 15 centimeters of water would tell you that patient has a high work of breathing. And in any patient, always look for the level of consciousness. Any patient with altered mental status, you have to step up your treatment. And this is a flow chart, typically not showing your HFNC and not showing your NIV, because HFNC has more evidence. So you start with nasal cannula, stepped up to NRB, go for HFNC. And with the HFNC, you can see the ROX index and see if the patient would continue with your HFNC if it's more than 4.88 at 12 hours. Or you need to, if it is the ROX index is less, you can think of a helmet, a non-invasive mask. And if it's very low, you may think of even intubation. So it's a flow chart for maintaining your patient's hygiene. We come to our last resort. We are forced to, or the patient's work of breathing is not coming down, we are forced to mechanically ventilate. That is intubation and mechanical ventilation. So typically what they say, the PF is usually less than. In classical ideas, what they say is less than 200, you have to intubate. For COVID, because of that vascular problem, we anticipate we have the cutoff limit to be as low as 150. So P by F less than 150, increased work of breathing. These are patients you would think of intubation. You have two categories of ventilation. That is either pressure control or volume control. So as you know, in pressure control category, we set the pressure. Okay. We ask the ventilator to give flows till the pressure reaches a particular value. And in that scenario, the volume that patient gets would vary between patients, even on the same patient at different points of time. So when you set the, when you go for pressure control mode of ventilation, some example, we set 20 centimeters of water. Okay. For a particular patient, the tidal volume obtained for 20 would be say 500 ml. Okay. Same 20 for another patient has a very stiff lung, you would have hardly 200 ml. Okay. So it is our responsibility to see that patient gets a target tidal volume when you go for pressure control mode of ventilation. We'll see what target tidal volume is. Whereas in volume control mode of ventilation, okay, the volume is set, for example, we said ask the ventilator to give 500 ml. Okay. And the pressure that is developed to give this 500 ml would vary depending upon the elastance or the how stiff your lung is or how narrow your tube is. So you know that tube connecting ventilator to the balloon or the alveoli. So this is category of ventilation, and under the pressure control, you have many modes like A-bar CME, IME, SIME. Okay. Under volume control, you also have A-bar CME like that. So for giving invasive mechanical ventilation, you need to intubate the patient. And that it is recommended that the most skilled person at intubation should be doing the procedure, that is to decrease the amount of aerosols that would develop during intubation. And video laryngoscopy has been suggested. I would still stick on to our normal laryngoscope if you are well versed with that. Okay, don't take a new technique when you're going to COVID patients. So that should be kept in your mind. A rapid sequence intubation is one scenario where you give the sedation. We usually intubate with fentanyl and scolin or ropronium. So you give both the drugs together, and you might you usually don't ventilate such patients, provide the oxygenation is adequate. Wait for say around 60 seconds and then go for a try to intubate this patient. Okay. And try to optimize. So if you're a bit weak in intubation, you can use a bougie or a stillet, which would help you to get better first attempt success. You can't auscultate. So the problem is that it's difficult for you to auscultate. You wear a coverall and you wouldn't be able to hear. So it is better to go for a ETCO2. But then if you don't have ETCO2, don't worry, you can see the chest rise. Okay. Chest rise, equal chest rise would be there. Again, you can connect to the ventilator and see the graphics. And remember, once you have intubated, you please go for a closed suction device, that is a apparatus or a device which need not be disconnected every time you want to give a suction. So it's basically a T-piece where the suction is attached to one end and the other end gets attached to your endotracheal tube. Third port would get attached to your ventilator tubing. So even when you ventilate patients, you can give, just introduce a suction tube and you can give closed suction. And also, because these patients would need more days on ventilator, you try to put in tubes which have suction aid that would help clear the secretions that collect just above the cuff. So it's called a subglottic suction or tubes with suction aid. And always use filters. So we'll see what kind of filters and where to place them. As you know, this is the PACA dual limb circuit that comes with the ICU ventilator. And you can see that this is the inspiratory port. So you can identify on the ventilator, there will be marking like this, or you would see a face of the patient. And then there will be marking towards the face of the patient. And so this is the inspiratory limb. It comes to a Y connector. And it is after the Y, you place the HME or HMEF. Most of our HMEs are HMEF. Okay. And then you have, most of the time, you might have something called a catheter mount or small tubing that would allow some play. If patient thala anakkiyalum idu korchonu oru vittu kodukum. Okay. So this is the patient then. So patient ventilator gases come from the ventilator, goes to the patient. And what happens when they come out? Yeah, they get filtered. If they have a HMEF, they get filtered and they come through the expiratory or exhalation limb. And here, before it reaches, goes into the ventilator, you have to keep a bacterial and viral filter. Okay. So it's so important to keep this here. So normally, maybe routine cases we don't keep, but then if you have a COVID ARDS, you have to keep this viral filter at the expiratory limb. So it gets filtered again and goes into the ventilator where it is measured. Okay. It is measured. Whatever gases is coming out from the lung is also measured, and then it is expelled to the atmosphere. Okay. That is what is happening. So you should know where to keep this HME and bacterial and viral filter. Okay. Again, I'm showing the duo guard, which has static electricity, and it is said that it knocks down viral particles rather than filter. It has also filtering capabilities also there, but it knocks down the viral particles. So that's the best duo guard, costs around 400 rupees, but when again, it's difficult to get because of the scarcity. So we go to the settings of the ventilator. You have intubated patient, you can select either pressure control or volume control. It is still hotly debated which is better, but in our circumstances where we have very little people to monitor, we would prefer to in a volume control mode of ventilation. As I've already said, the volume would vary in a pressure control. We'd like to have patients getting at least some tidal volume. We'd go for volume control mode of ventilation, but it might be at a cost of increasing pressure. So we'll see how to adjust the pressures also, what all pressures to look monitor during ventilating patients in volume control mode of ventilation, category of ventilation. And in that, we would start with A-bar CME. So in your newer ventilators, when you see volume VCV, it is actually A-bar CME mode. It is assist bar control where the patient can trigger a breath. Okay. Always start with FiO2-1 because you don't know how much oxygen would be most suitable for our patient, or with what FiO2 the patient would maintain the oxygen saturation. and then decrease. So start with one and then decrease. So lung protective ventilation has been shown to be beneficial for patients who have ARD. So it's called LPV, okay, lung protective ventilation. So what is lung protective ventilation? That is a low tidal volume, okay? It's not just the low tidal volume. It will have very certain endpoints in the pressure, okay? So you can go as low as 4 ml per kg. For normal patients, it is said that you have a tidal volume of 6 to 8 ml per kg, predicted body weight. So what is this predicted body weight? Your lungs don't grow when you become obese, okay? So you have to find the tidal volume according to the height of the patient. Okay, so that is a predicted body weight. You have to find the weight of the patient from the height of the patient. So you take some bony landmark at the top of your head or the top of your skull, and from there come down to your sternoclavicular joint, and from there go to your anterior superior iliac spine, go down to your lateral condyle, and then lateral malleolus. So that height is it to be recorded. And remember, for a patient who has 60 inches, male who has 60 inches, the weight would be 50 kg. For every inch above 60, add 2.3. It is very simple. You don't have to by heart the equation. For adult male having a height of 60 inches, the weight would be 50. So every inch above, you have to add 2.3. For females, that the weight is 45.5 for a patient who is 60 inches. Okay. From that, you can calculate the predicted body weight. Okay. So you start with 8 ml per kg, come down to 6 ml per kg. Okay. In 1 hour or 2 hours time, you come down to 6. And then see what is the pressure that is needed to deliver that 6 ml per kg predicted body weight. You have definite endpoints for the pressures. It's not giving the tidal volume irrespective of the pressures that are developed. Okay. Respiratory rate that you keep is based towards the patient's baseline. Okay, that means now, as you know, normal physiological rate is 12 to 20 or 10 to 20, but you don't go and keep 10 for a patient who has a baseline rate of say 35. So you keep it around 30. Okay, and then as I've told you, there are definite endpoints, pressure endpoints. So one of the endpoints is your peak pressure. Okay, peak pressure represents the total pressure that is needed to inflate the tube with the balloon or the alveoli. Okay. That is not very important. What we are concerned is with the alveolar pressure or the pressure in the balloon. And how do you identify that? You have to measure the P plate, plateau pressure, which represents the alveolar pressure. How do you measure the P plate? You have to give an inspiratory hold. That is there in the machine. You give that inspiratory hold for 0.5 seconds. Okay. And then see what is the pressure that is recorded. That will be shown in the screen. What is shown on the screen as P plat, you take that as the plateau pressure. And that reflects your alveolar pressure. So alveolar pressures should be less than 30 centimeters of water. So if you are ventilating the patient in 6 ml per kg predicted body weight, look at the plateau pressure, it's going high. You can come down to as low as 4 ml per kg. Come down to 50 kg, you can come down to as low as 200 ml tidal volume. Okay. And second pressure endpoint, endpoint is a driving pressure of less than 15 centimeters. So what is this driving pressure? Driving pressure is very simple. P plat minus PEEP. Okay. So you know about PEEP, we'll see what PEEP is, and that's the baseline pressure. Okay. So you have to subtract PEEP from your plateau pressure, you get the driving pressure. So these two goals should be met to say that it is a lung protective ventilation. Okay. So you should document all these things every 4 hours. You should measure the plateau pressure 4 hourly and see that you are in the safe pressure zones. So now we are in volume control. So always make sure that you give the tidal volume within the safe pressure limits or zones. Okay. Then you might be asked to select the sensitivity of trigger. So as I've told you, in A-bar CME mode, patient can trigger the ventilator. Okay, patient can take a breath unless and until you give muscle relaxants. So how much pressure drop should be there for the ventilator to sense, to understand the patient has taken a breath and the ventilator will give a full support to the patient once it is triggered. So how much drop in pressure should be there? It is usually 2 centimeters of water, or even if it's a flow trigger, you keep 2 liters per minute. So remember the value 2. When you ask to set the sensitivity, keep it as 2 centimeters of water or 2 liters per minute flow. Higher ratio is usually 1:2 is what we keep. And in ARDS, previous guidelines ask you to go for inverse ratio ventilation where the inspiration is more, but then there is little evidence. So we might go even to the extent of 1:1, but we don't go for inverse ratio ventilation. Flow pattern, it is again not very important, but if you are asked to, if you can select a flow pattern in a volume control mode of ventilation, please select the distillating flow pattern. It has some advantage in ARDS ventilation. And last but not the least, the PEEP. PEEP is the baseline pressure. Okay, at the end of exhalation, what is the baseline pressure? Normally it's zero, but then for all ventilated patients, we don't allow the pressures to come back to zero. We keep it at around 5. And adjust PEEP is one of the parameters you can adjust to improve your oxygenation. So start with 5, and the patient is not maintaining oxygenation. What there are different methods by which you can identify your PEEP. Okay, but one of the most easiest technique, what they say, is to just step up by 2. So 5 in 7 low to poor, and see when you increase the PEEP, you might have a drop in your BP or cardiac output. See what effect it has on your oxygenation as well as on your BP. And then you might need to increase your PEEP to as high as 10, maybe 12 or 15 to maintain your oxygenation. So remember, you keep a PEEP which does not adversely affect your hemodynamics. Okay. So we are ventilating this patient in A-bar CME mode of ventilation, volume control. Okay. What all things you should monitor? You can monitor the PEEP peak, but it's not very important. You have to monitor the plateau pressure. We already said it should be less than 30. You have to measure the drying pressure. That should be less than 15. And you can measure the compliance on the ventilator. Ventilator will show you the compliance of the lung. Compliance is the inverse of elastance. Compliance is how easily you can inflate a lung. Okay. So in typical ARDS, the compliance would be very low. You have a very stiff lung. Okay. And if your P-plat is high, what can you do? As I've told you, you have to decrease the tidal volume to as low as 4 ml per kg. So you have to adjust the tidal volume to maintain a P-plat less than 30 centimeters of water. So what would happen when we are decreasing the tidal volume? Patient would hypoventilate and retain count actually quite evident. Okay. They would milk ventilation would come down and they would retain count exit. So what do you do? We can't adjust the pressure, we can't adjust the tidal volume. The next option to improve or increase the milk ventilation is to increase the respirate rate to as high as 35 per minute. Okay, that's the maximum allowed. Okay. And then look at the compliance. If it is less than 40, a very stiff lung, you call it as the H-type or classical ARDS. If it's more than 40, you can label it as L-type. So there is a lot of studies have come out saying that L-type is just the initial stage. It will gradually go over to the H-type. Not for all patients, but very few patients would go to the progress to the classical ARDS picture. So depending on the compliance, you can adjust your ventilator settings. Suppose we have a good compliant lung. That means it's not very stiff. It's because of a vascular problem. You can increase the tidal volume to as high as 8 ml per kg. Again, all your plateau pressure should be less than 30. You can go for a higher FiO2 because we already said that it is the vascular problem. You would benefit from very high FiO2. PEEP would not be very effective. And PRON can be tried, but the exact reason why it works, it's not clear. And always monitor the compliance also. It will be shown on the ventilator. And if it goes to a very low compliance, you can go for the standard ARDS. Now we are going to discuss the low compliance, the classical ARDS ventilation. Okay. So there are many goals. One of the goals is to minimize mechanical power applied to the lung. So when you are giving positive pressure ventilation, you are actually damaging the lung. Okay. And by minimizing the mechanical power applied to the lung, you can decrease ventilation induced lung injury. It's not even the ventilator. So even patients who are taking deep breaths can have ventilation induced lung injury, and that's called as PCLE. Okay. So, and the power, mechanical power depends on the pressure and that to the driving pressure, P-plat minus PEEP. Okay. The rate and the flow. Okay. And second problem we should target or try to correct, you know that it is not a uniformly fluid filled lung in ARDS. Some areas would be more fluid filled. As I said, posterior would be more fluid filled compared to anterior. And you have to decrease the lung inhomogeneity. And as you can see here, this AA picture shows a normal lung. Okay. And when you give a volume, it is equally distributed to all the alveoli. Whereas when you have a alveolar that is fluid filled, okay, that acts as a stress raiser. You'll see what this stress and strain are. Okay, so when you give volume, that alveolar will not get filled. Okay, it is the rest of the alveolar, normal alveolar, getting overfilled. Okay, so we have to know some terminology. One is the strain. Strain is very simple. What is the tidal volume? What is the volume change? Okay, with respect to your initial volume, how, what is the delta V? Okay, that is a strain that is applied to your, we are trying to decrease the strain by giving low tidal volume. Okay, fine. What is the stress? Stress is the distending pressure. That's the pressure that is needed to give that particular volume. Okay, enlarged stress and strain of the lung arises not because of the diseased lung being stiff. Okay, it's not the stiffness of the lung, but the small volume that is taking part in the tidal volume. So you are giving the tidal volume, that will not go to the alveoli that are fluid filled. That will go to the alveoli which are ready to accept. That is almost a normal alveoli. And also because they are inhomogeneous, some of the alveoli would not, like we can't compartmentalize. We can't say that half of the below this level it will be fluid filled. No, we can't say. So some of the alveoli would be fluid filled at a higher level also. So because of the inhomogeneous nature and the small volume into which our tidal volume is pushed into, that will produce stress and strain, and both high stress and strain would damage our lung. So lung protective ventilation in ARDS have been proved from with your ARSNET trial, ARSNET 1 trial, which showed that low tidal volume ventilation is always protective. Okay, so what are the goals to say that you are in lung protective mode of ventilation? Goal number one, we already said plateau pressure less than 30. Okay, so if it's more than 30, decrease the tidal volume. Okay, to as low as 4. Yes, if your plateau pressure is less than 25 and your tidal volume is less than 6, that is not very good. We have some option to increase your plateau pressure to as high as 30. You can, and because especially when the tidal volume is less than 6, you can increase the tidal volume by 1 till the plateau pressure is more than 25. Your tidal volume. So what is our aim? Tidal volume of 6 and a plateau pressure less than 30. That is our aim. Okay. And if your plateau pressure is less than 30 and there is breath stacking, breath stack is one breath over the other, because you have increased the rate, you might have the scenario of one breath not being completely emptied before the next breath start. And breath stacking occurs, we don't keep that plateau pressure under 30. We can increase the tidal volume by 1 ml to 8 ml per kg. So that's a very rare scenario. Okay. Goal number two, we said that we are going for low tidal volume and that will definitely have hypoventilation and your carbon dioxide will go high, that will produce respiratory acidosis. So our pH goal is 7.3, not severe acidosis, marginal, minimal acidosis can be acceptable. 7.3 to 7.45 is your pH goal. So suppose your pH is less, it is less than 7.3, going to as low as 7.15. If you are not ventilating the patient with a respirator of 35, you can increase the respirator to 35 and see if your pH is more than 7.3. So if you have very severe respiratory acidosis, you may again increase the respirator rate up to 35. And ARSNET guideline gives you an option to give bicarb. Very paradoxical, okay? Very strange recommendation. You give bicarb, that is to buy time. So bicarb would give some relief, it would bring the pH a bit higher. But remember, bicarb is metabolized to carbon dioxide. And if your lungs again is not able to wash off your carbon dioxide, your respiratory acidosis may worsen. So it's not a very good recommendation, but if you don't have any other option, you may increase them. You may give bicarb and after increasing the respiratory to 35. So if your pH is more than 7.5, definitely decrease the rate. Goal number three, that is oxygenation. We never talked about oxygenation. What is the oxygenation goal? Yes, this is not the ARSNET goal. I have modified a bit because we have a recent study which showed that. Okay, we'll come to the study. So just remember, the oxygenation goal is 90 to 100 PaO2. Again, very high goal, very difficult to achieve. And SAC SpO2 of 94 to 96. ARSNET said only 88 to 93. But here we have just targeting a bit more. Again, very difficult to achieve. A very high goal that has been set. So how do you achieve your oxygenation? You can do it by two methods. You can either increase the FiO2. So most of our patients would already be on 100% oxygen. And next step is to increase your PEEP. So also, again, depending also, you can increase your peak. And again, as I've told you, there are different techniques. One technique I already said, gradually increase your peak by increments of 2 and look into the BP. There is another chart that comes up with the ArtsNet trial. That chart would give you a arbitrary combination of FiO2 and the peep you would start with. Or suppose you are in 0.7 FiO2 and peep of 10, oxygenation is not meant. You move right side, you go to the right side. Till you maintain FiO2, till you give FiO2 of 1, 100% oxygen and a peep of high, very high peep of 18 to 24. Maybe again, if you don't have this chart, don't worry. You gradually increase your peep by 2 and see the effect it has on the oxygenation as well as the hemodynamics. Unfortunately, most of the patients who are really bad will not improve by doing all these methods. Okay, so you can use the term refractory hypoxemia when your PO2 is less than 60 millimeters of mercury, okay, or a saturation is less than 88, or a PBF is less than 100, with the FiO2 of more than 0.5. So, in spite of giving more than 50% oxygen, your saturation is not maintained. And with a peep of more than 10. So in spite of giving high peep and high FiO2, you're not happy with your oxygenation. So what do we have in this scenario? Okay, and most of our patients who are intubated would be having refractory hypoxemia. Very difficult scenario to treat. So can you allow the patient to be in hypoxemia? To what extent? Again, very difficult. There are no guidelines to say this much of oxygen is safe. Can you go for very higher peep, much higher peep? Are there special modes? Can you use atracurium or cisatracurium, maybe vecronium, neuromuscular blockers? Can you turn the patient upside down, prone position? Can we recruit the lung? We said many of the alveoli are fluid filled or even collapsed because of the debris. So can we open them with recruitment manuals? Can we keep them after opening them with high pressures? Can we keep them open with high peep, that's called the open lung concept, and it has little evidence? Or can we give some kind of lung rest and take the work that is done by the lung to a machine? Can we use ECMO? So there are many studies that has been done. But remember, all these things, whatever high pressures we go for, whatever recruitment manual we use, whatever prone position we use, this, okay, should not produce ventilation-induced lung injury, and it should not adversely affect your cardiovascular system. So your lungs and heart are so tightly, they have a lot of relationship. So once when your lungs go bad, your heart can also go bad. So coming to refractory hypoxemia, what they say is that, what are the parameters we would look for hypoxemia or oxygen saturation? As I've said, PO2, P by F, SPO2, lactate, again telling you anaerobic metabolism, or your SVO2 is a mixed venous oxygen that comes to your, after circulating, it comes to your back to your heart, mixed venous oxygen saturation. Okay. But what they say is that all these are very imprecise surrogates of your oxygenation. What actually you should measure is to go to individual organ, go inside the cell and measure the oxygen there. That is not possible. So till that comes, we would still stick on to this imprecise surrogates of oxygenation. And they said that ArtsNet said that PO2 of 55 to 80 is enough, and a saturation of 88 to 94 is enough for patients. Okay. Then came a study that's called the ICU ROCK study that included patients in all the patients in the ICU, not just the ARDS patients, all the patients in ICU, and they found that by targeting very high oxygen, like saturation of 100, the mortality increases. Okay, so that study showed that it's bad. So we again came back to 94 is enough. Okay, but another study came up recently, 2020, which is called LOCO2, which is nothing but liberal or conservative oxygen therapy for ARDS patients, only ARDS patients. And they found out that, interestingly, it is a multicentric trial including 201 patients, and found that patients who had lower oxygen had higher mortality. There were a lot of complications like mesenteric ischemia that developed patients who were allowed to go for very low oxygen. And so they said that at least 94% to 96% of saturation is ideal for patients who are in ARDS, not for COVID, but generally speaking, before COVID, they said 94 saturation should be maintained. But further studies are needed to exactly prove. So we would try to achieve, say, at least 92 to 94 is a reasonable target. Again, a very difficult target to achieve. Then we come to different modes. Is one mode superior to the other? To put it very briefly, no mode is superior. No category of ventilation is superior. Is PCV superior? No. So little evidence suggests that airway pressure release ventilation has some edge. It's a great idea. It has little hard evidence. So we need more studies in APRV to say that ARDS patients should benefit from APRV. So one study in adult was positive and the study was negative. I will not go into the details. Coming to the PEEP, okay, what does PEEP do? We are not allowing the lung to totally come down empty and come allow the pressures to come down, come to atmospheric pressure or zero. Okay, so PEEP prevents intertidal collapse. So when you have diseased alveoli, they would totally shut down during your exhalation. They are sticky and they would totally shut down. Okay, when these alveoli are sticky, in the next inspiration, they need high pressures to open up this sticky alveoli, collapsed alveoli. So when you maintain a PEEP, that is prevented, and it will also improve the mean airway pressure. It would improve your oxygenation. So what is the best PEEP? Again, there are different methods to find that. Okay, so I told you adequate oxygenation, and it will not adversely affect your hemodynamics. So there are different methods. We'll not go into the details. So as I've already said, you can either go by one technique, that is small increments of PEEP, say steps of two, and see what it affects on the hemodynamics as well as oxygen. Or another simple method is the table that I've shown multiple times. You go rightward if your oxygenation goal is not met. Okay, just go rightwards. And high PEEP trials, they did trials and found out that higher PEEP did not improve the mortality. Another thing they found was that one simple ventilator graphics might tell you whether you are over distending the lung. So actually, when you give the volume, you should not over distend the alveoli. That's called a stress index. Look into the pressure time graph and see the representation of the graph. So if you see that graph is pointing towards the pressure axis at the top, that means stress is more than one, and it tells you that you are over distending. Where it is coming down, it is you can give some more volume. So normally you want the graph to go as a straight line like this. Okay. Coming to the use of neuromuscular blocker, very controversial again, because we have one study which said that Atracurium was good. It had anti-inflammatory action. 48 hours use is good. But a recent study that's called the Rose trial, which came out and said that there is no difference. Okay. But we may still use, because the moment you intubate and patient comes out of the scholine or the first muscle relaxant you give, there will be a lot of dyssynchrony, a lot of distress in the patient because of that hypoxemia and things. And you might be needing good sedation as well as muscle relaxants at least for some time before you stick on to your latest guideline and say that you don't give muscle relaxants. But most of our patients would get muscle relaxants because of the distress and the dyssynchrony. So here also in the latest study also, they say that if there is a lot of dyssynchrony, you can use muscle relaxants. Okay. Then coming to opening up those areas which are collapsed, that's called recruitment. Again, there are different methods of recruitment, but nothing has been shown to be better than the other, or it has not been shown that recruitment manuals improve the mortality. It might improve your oxygenation for a bit time, but it does not have effect on your mortality. So we don't go for much of recruitment, but as a last resort, we may use recruitment because there is nothing much to offer. So one of the recruitment manual that has been suggested is a high pressure for a high time. So 40 pressures for a 40 seconds is one of the recruitment manuals that has been suggested. But generally speaking, lung recruitment manuals don't have much evidence. Okay, coming to the prone position, again, very simple thing that we can do without much money. Okay, and it has been found to be effective by the PROCEVA trial. As already said, how it will be effective. So which all patients would be prone? So after intubating and ventilating, your P by F remains less than 150. So this recommendation came before our COVID. So they say that if the P by F less than 150, you can think of proning. And your FiO2 is more than 0.6, still the P by F is less than 150 with a higher PEEP. So you start with around 12 to 16 hours of prone position. Usually start in the morning, or by say around 11 o'clock you prone the patient and you make the patient supine only on the next day. Okay, it can be increased to as long as 18 hours. So long duration of proning and early proning has shown benefit. Okay, so when to stop? Naturally, oxygenation is better. Your FiO2 has come down and PEEP has come down. So definitely, hemodynamic compromise is one. But then, if the patient is on a single support, that does not make a very big, it's not a high contraindication. But you can still individualize to patients. Okay. So you give prone ventilation for 16 hours in the first shift. Make the patient supine. Take an ABG and see that the oxygenation are maintained, that the PBUF is more than 150, and this oxygenation improvement should last more than 4 hours. If this scenario is met, you can continue prone position. You can continue your sessions. Okay. Suppose your oxygenation gets worsened, carbon dioxide retention is there. That is, again, after making the patient supine, take an ABG and see there is retention of carbon dioxide, then you can think of ECMO. Okay, this criteria is for patients who are maintain prone, and then next day you come and make them supine and do the ABG. But so once you have prone the patient, say at 11 o'clock, and the patient goes back, at 12 o'clock you take an ABG and see the PBUF has come down to is dropped by 20%. You have to make the patient supine. So that is making the patient supine just after making the patient prone. So the first one was whether you should continue proning or not. So that is said after you take a ABG, after making the supine, patient making the patient supine, and then oxygenation the improvement in oxygenation should last more than 4 hours, you can continue your prone position. Okay, this is a very brief video to show three people is enough. Okay, first thing, preparation. Good communication should be there. Everybody should be wearing this PPE. So center line actually should be up in the first step. Make sure all the cables are free, including catheters, rise tube, ventilator tubing, BP. So make sure you turn the position of the head every 2 hours. So in spite of proning, we are not able to achieve our oxygenation. The last step we have is ECMO, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. And the scenario would be a very high FiO2, tidal volume of 6 and PEEP of more than 10, and prone position has been tried already. But still the oxygenation is less than 50 for more than 3 hours, or the PEEP is less than 100 with a high FiO2 of 1. Okay. and the patient retains carbon dioxide, we have respiratory acidosis and plateau pressure more than 30, or the patient has concomitant cardiogenic shock or even has sustained a cardiac arrest, we can go for ECMO. So there are guidelines that have been set laid out by the ELSO society organization regarding COVID. One of the recommendations is that don't start ECMO centers for COVID patients. So you should be having an ECMO running before the COVID. So in such centers, you can go for ECMO. And do give ECMO for patients who have only a favorable outcome. Okay. And that should be done only after maximizing your traditional therapies, like even prone positioning. And VV ECMO, that's veno-venous, is done for respiratory support. Veno-arterial is done for circulatory support also. And don't go for eCPCR, that is ECMO, CPCR with ECMO, in less experienced center or centers without an existing eCPCR facility. And you have a checklist that you should tick regarding the inclusion criteria and excluding criteria. And if suppose our patient improves, okay, you should see that the oxygenation has improved. You can also look into your RSBI, that's the Tobin's index, that is nothing but the respiratory rate divided by tidal volume in liters. Again, that there are many indices that will help you to feel that, tell you that weaning would be successful. So if the RSBI is less than 105, it is okay, patient can be weaned. But if it's more than, say, 105, it has more negative predictive value. So 97% of patients would fail the trial. So you should have a minute ventilation between 5 to 10 liters. Tidal volume should be more than 5. And which all mode would you use? So you have the option of pressure support ventilation. Pressure support mode of ventilation is a weaning mode. So in that, whatever setting, what setting would you use? You would use a pressure support of around 6 and a PEEP of 5. Okay. And you can also have TPs, but we don't prefer TPs in COVID because of aerosol. You can extubate to NIV. Again, not very useful. So you can also use HFNC after extubation. And so our pressure support ventilation would still hold good. And once the patient passes around, say, 2 hours of trial of this setting, you can think of extubation, provided the patient is fully awake and very cooperative. Okay. Extubation can be done. You can use aerosol box, but then some studies have come up saying that aerosol box should not be used for intubation because it might even increase the amount of a virus that you are exposed to. So it is, again, an aerosol generating procedure. And you can switch over to HFNC, but remember, you might have cord edema. Vocal cord edema might be there. And tracheostomy might be needed in patients who need prolonged ventilation, usually done by the 10th day. You also, I think this is covered by Dr. Arvind, coagulopathy. You should think of adding heparin, and especially a higher dose for patients who have severe disease. And I think that has been discussed earlier. Cytokine release syndrome that can occur by around, say, 7 days of your illness, and you can treat that with tocilizumab, a very difficult condition to treat. Almost caring about the patient, almost stable at nikim, pettana oxygenation status and deteriorating. So always think of cytokine release at that particular point of time, and you have to step up your treatment, but not very easy to get tocilizumab. Okay. And then drugs also should have been discussed. Convalescent plasma should have been discussed. Okay, all this have been discussed. General measures, always sedate the patient, especially when you begin your ventilation. And you can avoid muscle relaxants when you give deep sedation. Steroids have been discussed. Again, early enteral feeding, whenever possible, please give patients RILS2 feeding. Continuous is better. And any patient who can be fed orally is conscious before intubation, please feed them. And go for renal replacement therapy if you have a acute kidney injury and things like that. Antibiotic for secondary bacterial. And all your protocols should be there, like your VAP prevention bundle, your CRBSA bundle, all these things. So if you are not supposed to be using nebulizers, so next option is the MDI, meter dose inhalers. You have adapters that come with closed suction and other tubings you can use. But okay, so you have to keep that adapter very near the patient's endotracheal tube. So HME or the HMEF should be towards the ventilator side. So then only this drug would go into the patient. And this is a general recommendation for taking rounds during in the ICU. So always remember IHUG fast SBAD. So think of infection control. Should I step up your antibiotics? Is the infection getting controlled? You have to elevate the head of bed 30 to 45 degrees. Give ulcer prophylaxis. Again, you have definite indications, but generally most of your patients would need, especially patients who are on ventilator, pantoprazole is the preferred. Glycemic control should be 140 to 180. Feeding, you see that patient is getting adequate calories, around 25 to 30 kilocalories per kg. Analgesia, any patient pain should be given analgesics. Sedation is as needed. Thrombophylaxis, yes, it's very important in COVID patients. See if the bowels have opened. Okay, so it's normally every third day the bowels should open. Any invasive lines that needs to be removed, please. So we'd have patients with 4 IV cannulas and sister is giving only using only 1 line. Remove all the rest. De-escalation of antibiotics. When I feel that patient does not need these antibiotics further, please de-escalate. So this is the summary of, we'll summarize. All the interventions are here and many of them have different uses or help that would be done to the patient. Don't forget awake proning and don't forget to prone patients early after intubation if the patient is not maintaining oxygenation after even intubation mechanism. Very easy process to do, but then you have to monitor the patient. You have to turn the head every 2 hours to one side or the other and the other. I hope I've covered most of that. I will have some time for this.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful session. How much percentage of happy hypoxia seen in COVID percentage COVID patients? That is one question by Dr. Babu from Marikod.
So as per literature from Italy and these things, they started with said that 50% of their patients have hypoxemia. But here we see that, but not very commonly. So by the time these patients come to your ICU, maybe they would be more commonly seen in wards and rooms where they are housed before they come to ICU. In the ICU, we have seen patients who are comfortable with a saturation of say 88, 84. They are happy. They don't complain of hypoxemia. Shwasam muttunnu parayara illa. Avarku avaru saturation kaanunnillallo. Nammalalle kaanadu. Appo we would get frightened and then ask them, are you okay? They say, I am okay. So maybe you do 5-10% of patients we have seen, but most of them already on NIV and they would be intubated. So maybe these are the things that you should more look for in ward patients.
So how long can you use Duloga? That is one question.
How long can you use what? I didn't hear you.
Duloga.
Okay, very good, very good. So the company recommends 3 days. 3 days. And they also say that you can use a maximum of 5 days, but then you have to remove that once it is soiled. So if there is secretions and blood in that, you have to remove, even if it is day one. But otherwise, if it's a clean, you can just see that it's clean. You can use that for 3 days. That is a company recommendation. They also said maximum for 5 days they can use. It's worth buying that.
So for Duloga, can we ETO or plasma sterilize it? And
no. It's disposable.
I'm going through the questions. Please give me a moment to identify the question. Sir, how long will a person will go through the happy hypoxia? That is one question.
Okay, see, they would come to your ICU with a saturation of say 82. And we monitor the workup breathing, and sometimes we keep non-rebreathing mask or HFNC. They'll improve with that. Okay, they will improve with that. And then over meanwhile we start all the medicines like anti-inflammatory, antiviral, and they improve. So day one they would be on HFNC. Okay, day two they would accept the oxygen should be maintained even if the HFNC is removed. Okay, and then we give oxygen mask. So intermittent they improve. Very few patients would progress on to the S phenotype.
Sir, one comment is driving pressure is equal to P plat minus PEEP. Probably that person might need a confirmation or what?
Yes, correct. P plat minus PEEP. That is the pressure that is needed to inflate your alveoli.
Then can we use hypo nasal oxygen with room air? That is one question.
Usually while weaning the HFNC, you come down the flow rates to as low as 20 liters. You don't come down to below 15 to 20 liters. If you want to use room air, it is an option where you don't have oxygen. But remember, these patients, most of them would benefit other patients who have hypoxemia, and what they need is basically oxygen rather than the PEEP or the other effects or advantages of HFNC. So it is ideally to be used in areas with oxygen, because that is the pathophysiology. They need, patients need oxygen rather than the positive. Positive pressure and oxygen will help better on the look.
Sir, which is the preferred muscle relaxant in...
Okay, sesatracurum is the preferred. So we don't... we use atracurium, but remember, atracurium has auto degradation. If you don't keep that in the correct temperature, the drug will get auto degraded. So most of our atracurium will not work. So if it is very mandatory that you should have the patient totally relaxed, atracurium is the one you have to use. But because of this problem, we sometimes use Vecroni also. Sedative, we have two options: fentanyl as well as midazolam. Midazolam may produce delirium, but fentanyl is not commonly available in all places. So we use midazolam, even doses of say 3 to 5 mL per hour.
Can we increase flow rate beyond 15 liter using normal flow meter?
The bobbin will not increase more than 15, but still, if you can go on increasing till the knob allows, you may be giving more than 15 liters. That is something which is not recommended by the people who make this. You are supposed to keep it there at 15. But if you can increase, the bobbin will not increase, but the flows might be higher.
If we keep increasing the flow meter, will the FiO2 increase in high flow nasal cannula?
Yeah, definitely. That is how you adjust the FiO2. You adjust the FiO2 by adjusting the flow in the flow meter.
Okay. Even beyond 15 liter?
Yeah, you can go on increasing the flow, but ideally it should be used with flow meters that allow you to go up to 30 liter per minute.
Sistrac is not available. That is one sentence. Sistrac.
Okay, you can use atracurium.
Then, if there is a steep rise in D-dimer and an acute onset worsening of hypoxemia and hemodynamic instability with a dilated RIRV, can thrombolysis be done?
Yes. Ideally, it should be confirmed with your CTPA. So it might be difficult to shift the patient to this thing, and then they might have a acute kidney injury, which might prevent you by hold you for your contrast, which is again injurious to your kidney. So ideally, if you have confirmed, you have no other option, you can try thrombolysis. You can try.
Is there a role of NA before failure in first 24 hours first 24 hours or re-intubate?
First 24 hours before re-intubation.
Or re-intubation.
Bridging with NIV is okay. So you can extubate and then keep NIV or HFNC to maintain your oxygenation. But at that time, you should be very, very careful. Double careful that patient will not go to an arrest.
In high flow nasal cannula, if we go high on flow rate. Is there a chance of barotrauma?
High flow nasal cannula, very less likely, because the pressures don't go up very high, because there is always a leak between the cannula and your nas opening. So there is a leak. So it will say, what they say is that when you give a flow of 10, the PEEP is almost 1 centimeters of water. So even if you keep 60 liter flow, the PEEP would be only 6. And this patient should keep their mouth closed for better development of PEEP. So a very less chance of barotrauma.
So maximum possible flow rate, which can be used in 30 LPM. How can we use the flow rate to 60 LPM?
That is see, you give 30 liter oxygen, rest will be taken by the machine from the atmosphere. So 30 liter 100% oxygen, 30 liter that is you have a your what you call turbine there, which would drag in air, and that is how it provides the flow. Machine will take up from the atmosphere, so rest 30 would be taken, so you'd have a mixture, final mixture would be 60 liter per minute containing 50% oxygen. Rest would be taken from the atmosphere.